those notes came from the very talented hands of Ms. Carol Parker. Carol, thank you for that medley. I was listening to that last song, and I couldn't help but have those words play in my mind. You can have this whole world, just give me Jesus.
Amen.
Isn't that the hope and comfort that we've gathered here to celebrate and rejoice in today when we think about the life of Miss Mildred Barber? Before we begin, just a couple of introductions. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Charlie Mayberry. I'm the pastor at First Baptist here in Waycross, and I've been here in my fifth year, but those 5 years have been made all the more better and wonderful by the occasion and opportunity to know Miss Mildred Barber. It makes me a little jealous because I know Reverend Mark Williams behind me has had an opportunity to know her a whole lot longer than I have, so I'm jealous there. And to top it all off, I know he's hiding over in the corner, but Brother Bill Young is here, pastor now of Sweat Memorial Baptist, but pastor at Central Baptist, and where Miss Mildred was a member. And to top it all that off, I've introduced everybody else. It's been wonderful to see all of you, family and friends. I know if Miss Mildred could have a smile on her face beneath this pall, that's what she would be smiling about right now. Her friends are here. So with that said, let me begin with a word and prayer of comfort. Almighty God, we know that you are the author and perfecter of our faith. And as with any good book, all of the pages are open for the Master's hand to write his story. God, we're grateful today to come and gather and celebrate the story and the masterpiece that you have written through the life of your daughter, your child, Mildred Barber. Lord, I pray that as we reflect upon her life, as we celebrate and rejoice in her homecoming today, that, Lord, we mix words of joy and rejoicing with words of comfort and hope. God, that you would bind them all together through your Holy Spirit, the seal and guarantee of our salvation. God, would you do these things to your honor and glory? In Jesus' name, amen.
Patricia, it's an honor to be asked to sing at Mildred's service today. Mildred was a very dear friend, and I thought the world of her. When she first came to First Baptist Church, one of the first things that she told me was she did not want one of these little Christian hugs, you know, where you put one arm over somebody and pat them on the shoulder. You know what I'm talking about, right? It's like COVID hugs type thing. She wanted a full-blown frontal attack hug. And so we kind of had our little thing. And she would, man, that's what we do. I love to think that when she got to the gates of heaven, Jesus was standing there and he gave her that frontal attack hug just as hard as she could stand it. And I will miss her, but I am glad for the assurance of salvation and knowing where she is today. Patricia asked that I share a hymn with you that you know, Trust and Obey. And Mildred told her, I guess she was about 10 years old when she accepted Christ, that this was the song they were playing, singing, when she came forward to make a profession of faith. And what a great tribute to her God and to her to sing this song. And if I don't say this, Mildred will have words with me when I get there. But I can tell you that if you have not taken an opportunity to trust and obey, and you can't look back in your life and know there was a point where you accepted Jesus into your heart and he became the Lord of your life, I invite you to do that today. And you can spend eternity with us in heaven too. And I know that Charlie or Brother Bill or myself, probably many others, would be glad to share that with you after the service. And now I have talked so much that my mouth is dry and I can't sing. So give me just a second. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. Let us do His good will. He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toll He doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Thank you, Mark. So glad you brought that water bottle with you, because if your mouth was dry and you couldn't sing and they had to rely on me, y'all would have been in trouble. This would not be a service of comfort at that point.
That's not true.
It says that I am to offer for you words of comfort, and I hope to be able to do that. Patricia, I echo Mark's sentiment. Thank you so much for the honor. Jane, thank you for the honor of coming here today and speaking on behalf of Miss Mildred. I've been thinking for the last several days of what would be the most appropriate thing to say, to share with you today. When you have someone who has lived 95 years on this earth, there is a lot of material to draw from. And so as a pastor and a preacher, you always want to make sure that if you're ever on the platform or at the pulpit and someone speaks before you, you just pray in all humility, Lord, just don't let it be so good I couldn't possibly follow it. And that's really kind of how I feel, Patricia, about speaking after that obituary that you wrote and shared. What wonderful and beautiful words. I hope you don't mind. I'm not going to plagiarize. You're sitting right here, but I'm going to draw from some of those in my remarks today. If you did not receive a copy of it, it's right outside on the table. I hope you'll take it with you. It'll be a blessing to you. One of the things that struck me first and foremost are the words that were shared this week regarding Miss Mildred was that she died peacefully. Mildred Barber died peacefully. Now that was the beginning of a conversation about a life well lived that we have come here today to recognize and give honor to. But what tied that together for me in such a powerful way, and I hope that everything I share between these two points makes sense, but wasn't that so much she died peacefully. Don't we all long to do just that, to literally die and leave this world in peace? But she lived peacefully. To live peacefully and to die peacefully. Well, that tells a story, doesn't it? Mildred's story began August the 10th, which I was very happy to hear. My birthday's August the 16th, so us fellow August folks, I gravitate towards. But August the 10th, 1926, born here in Waycross to William Charles and Lucy Weddington. Mildred was a local girl, born and raised, lived her life here in Waycross. I think back at her teenage years would have been right around the war years. So, and even then in Mildred's young life, what fascinating things that she saw and was a witness to, the Great Depression, the war years. During that time, if my my timeline here serves me correct, she met the love of her life, her husband Cy, working at the Lyric Theater, which is right down the street from First Baptist. I pass it often. Now I've got another story to think about it. Mildred was selling tickets in the window, and while she was selling tickets, Cy was taking tickets as the usher. They met one another, and that began a love and a romance that would last a good portion of their life, that would produce Patricia. And later on, Mildred would also keep books for that for the Lyric Theater. And I tell you these things, you can, again, find them in the obituary. But I hope that you get a scope of what an incredible life this lady lived. Selling tickets, she also went on to sell war bonds. Mildred is a part of the greatest generation, which many of you here are today. That should come as no surprise to any of us, as she embodied so many wonderful attributes and characteristics that are so commonly associated with such a wonderful generation of folks. Throughout the rest of her life, in addition to doing all of these things, here's just a few of the highlights in which Mildred Barber did and participated in. She was a long-distance operator. She prepared tax returns, we won't falter for that, for the IRS. She was a poll worker for elections. And this last one I find very hard to believe. I would have loved to have seen it. A court bailiff. Now, I cannot see sweet, beautiful, wonderful Miss Mildred have to get tough with somebody and tell them where they need to sit and stand and so forth. I just can't see that, but I wouldn't put it past her. These are the things that Mildred did. These are her occupations, the things that she invested her time and her talents in. But what I found most interesting about that obituary and just hearing some of your reflections on your mother and stories about your lives together is that although Mildred was self-described as meek and mild, I don't believe there was ever an adventure that she came across that she did not take time to entertain. I don't think over the course of her life she ever turned down an opportunity to live a little. She resonated with the spirit of one of her favorite authors, Willa Cather, who once proposed the following statement. She said, "I shall not die of a cold. I shall die of having lived." 95 years. This lady didn't close her eyes in peace from a cold. She closed her eyes having lived a life well. Mildred saw the world. She, along with Patricia, her daughter, and I would say partner in crime, took frequent cross-country road trips, which I do hope one day you will write down stories of all these adventures that you had together. Road trips across the United States, and as if one continent could hold the two of you, you also hopped an ocean and toured, I believe, England, Ireland, France, Spain, lots of other places. So many adventures along the roads of life. No road and countryside could not contain meek and mild Mildred's fancy for a good adventure. In addition to the road trips, she saw fit to go ahead and just, for good measure, tack on 4 river cruises, and I believe you said more than 20 voyages at sea to all sorts of ports and places around the world. Patricia, I love the beautiful words that you voiced in your mother's obituaries as you shared those thoughts and reflections. Patricia shared, before her eyes closed in death, they saw sunrise at Stonehenge on the summer solstice, reindeer at rest on a patch of snow in Norway, the Swan Lake Ballet performed in Russia, Queen Elizabeth at the Giant's Causeway in Northern Ireland. Now, I'm jealous of this next one, the Book of Kells in Dublin, pink dolphins in the Amazon, whoever heard of such a thing? Icebergs in Greenland, the midnight sun, and epic sunsets in the South Pacific. Could she have squeezed anything else? Make no mistake about it, Mildred Barber lived. Some of this sounds truly unbelievable, doesn't it? Sweet, little, meek, and mild Mildred did all of these things. Well, what if I told you, would you even believe me, if I shared with you that during the course of her life that she did something even greater than all of these adventures combined? What if I told you that she lived above and beyond these experiences to an even higher calling? Would you believe me? Well, you would have to, because those of you who knew Mildred, who knew Si, who knew her as a mother, a wife, a friend, and ultimately knew her as royalty, and I'll get to that in just a little bit, has nothing to do with Queen Elizabeth in that meeting. Mildred Barber understood the calling of a wife and a mother, and she excelled at it. She lived and breathed Proverbs 31 character. As a woman, she embodied it. She knew something about love that is forged, that is tested, that is proven through the heart of sacrifice, in service, in love, in encouragement, and support of others. Now, I don't know about you, but it makes me wonder how in the world she was able to balance all of these things. But balance she did. Mildred understood the value of being a good friend, an avid encourager, and a faithful heart and nature that described and defined her to the core. I don't want to go long today. I really want to keep it simple. But there's one thing left to say about Mildred, and it is the single most important aspect of her life. It is the only thing that matters here today. It influenced, oversaw, and overshadowed all of the rest. There is nothing more important, and it is what gives us joy and peace on an occasion such as this. I shared with you earlier that Mildred Barber was royalty, and she was. She was and is a daughter of the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. She is a child of God, a sister and co-heir with Jesus Christ. Mildred loved Jesus. He was her Savior, and she was, without a shadow of a doubt, one of God's precious and choicest children. As I mentioned earlier, she was a longtime member of the Central Baptist Church. She later moved her membership to First Baptist Church, where, as her pastor, I'm quite happy and thankful. She was a servant, an encourager, and a lifelong learner when it came to Scripture. Mildred faithfully attended church whenever she could, and at the end, even times when she probably couldn't. But on the arms of her partner in crime, y'all huddled together and came anyway, didn't you? If you can look at my notes, you'll see that they're blank now. I've come to the end of the things I wanted to make sure I didn't forget. But I want to close these words of comfort with some personal observations. You see, I am a first-time senior pastor. I guess I can't use that excuse anymore. It's been 5 years now. But when I came to First Baptist, I had been an associate pastor for over 20 years. I thought that kind of experience and qualifications would prepare me for everything I needed to know to be a senior pastor. It did not. Totally different ballgame. But as a first-time pastor, you want to, when you're preaching or when you're visiting, you want to reach out and gravitate towards the things that are going to encourage you. And I'm not ashamed to say, I gravitated and locked on to your mother. Whenever you're preaching to an audience such as this, or you're looking out across the sanctuary, you try to find those faces of encouragement. And all I had to do was just look right over here to my right. And there she sat, often with you. In Psalm 27, the psalmist, or excuse me, 42, the psalmist says this. You'll find these words familiar. As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs and pants for you, God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before my God? Psalm 127, it also, the psalmist asked the question, when can I go to the house of the Lord? And I imagine that question was asked with great joy. That's the encouragement. That's the excitement. That's the love, the faithfulness, the passion that I always found in Miss Mildred when I looked right over there where she sat. She was joyful to be in the house of the Lord. It didn't matter the circumstances. I remember when we first came back from COVID. There's you. You guys came right on in. You had your mask on. You sat down and you began to worship. And I know she was so happy to be there because she told me so. The other thing I found very interesting about your mother was something that happened just a few weeks ago. Just a reminder of the lady that we came today to celebrate and to recognize and remember. Sometimes when you go out to the Jones Center, you usually go, and the visit could go one or two ways. Sometimes it's a joyful visit. Sometimes, depending on who you're visiting and the situation, it could be taxing. I had been on a particularly difficult visit that particular afternoon, not difficult because of the person, but difficult because of the circumstances. And I remember going down the hallways, just carrying that burden in my mind. It was on my heart. I was trying not to take it into the room with your mother. And I walked into Mildred's room, and I'm not making this up. It was sunshine. It was warmth. It was wonderful. She was sitting on the edge of her bed with her feet draped over, and she was wearing some kind of extremely comfortable-looking jumpsuit. I really don't know how to describe it, except that's what it looked like. Had on some comfortable slippers, and just sticking out of the top of that jumpsuit was her little head and face, and she had the biggest smile to greet her pastor. I was coming there to minister to her, to check on her, and I'm not ashamed to tell you right here, right now, she ministered to me more. Before I could ask her about herself, Pastor, how's your family? How's your wife? How's your daughters? How have you guys been doing? Did you get over that sickness? Are you okay? And I finally had to say, Miss Mildred, I'm here to see you. She was eating a meal, watching TV, and very much looking forward to the fact that you were coming the very next day. I prayed with her. I apologized. I had to leave earlier than I wanted to. and I promised her I would see her again. I didn't have that opportunity, but because of her faith in Jesus Christ, I will. You will. We will, won't we? I came across one more quote I want to share with you from Miss Willa Cather, who I do want to hear more about. I know that you loved, both of you loved her writings. But here's what she had to say. The miracles of the church seem to me to rest not so much on faces or voices or healing power coming suddenly near to us from afar, but upon our perceptions being made finer, so that for a moment our eyes can see and our ears can hear what has been there about us all the while. Now, why would I share that about your mother? Because it leaves me with a familiar passage of Scripture that I don't know that I've ever preached, per se, at a funeral or a time such as this, but I think it very appropriate. Mildred Barber recognized that which was important, that which was near, that whom, the one whose presence inhabited every moment of her life from 10 years old forward. Jesus says it best when he's leaving the disciples at the end of the Gospel of Matthew in that beautiful passage of the Great Commission. And Jesus came and he spoke to them saying, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to follow all that I commanded you. And behold," don't miss this, "I am with you always to the end of the age." He was with them. He promised to be with them. He's with us always. He was with your mother always. And will be with her and she with him always to the end of the age because of her faith and her trust in his finished work on the cross. She knows the reality of that empty tomb. Your mother, your friend, our friend, this dear sweet lady, is alive and well with Jesus Christ. Jesus also shared with his disciples in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, "Do not let your heart be troubled." Don't leave here with trouble today. "Believe in God and believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. And if that were not so, I would have told you, because I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I am coming again. And I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you will also be." On that evening of February the 6th, your mother died peacefully. She left this world and was ushered into that full, straight-on, bodied hug that Mark was talking about from Jesus. She's with him. And aren't you glad? Isn't that why we rejoice here today? Today, we remember, we celebrate a life lived well. The life of Mildred Barber. If you have the little booklet that was given to you as you came in, you'll see on the back there a listing of the 23rd Psalm. The family has asked that we, as this great cloud of witnesses, share in the reading of that psalm together in honor of the Lord and in honor of Mildred Barber. Would you join me as we read it aloud together? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And repeat that one more time. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Amen. Now, Miss Jane has some words to come and share with us today.
One of the moments Patricia and I shared with Mildred occurred at the close of our time with her each day. As we would be getting ready to leave, one of us would ask if she would like to have the devotional of the day, which came out of this book. The response was always twinkling eyes, a smile, and an enthusiastic yes. Mildred left us in the early hours of Sunday, February 6th. We never got to read her that day's devotional, but I am sure she already knew and believed its message. The story is Sweet Sleep, and it comes from Proverbs 3, 19 through 24. I would like to share this with you. Proverbs 3, 19 through 24. When you lie down, you will not be afraid, and your sleep will be sweet. When my friend Floss lies awake at night, she thinks about lyrics of the hymn, My Jesus, I Love Thee. She calls it her middle of the night song because it helps her to remember God's promises and the many reasons she loves him. Sleep is necessary, but sometimes it's elusive, part of life. At times we may sense the voice of the Holy Spirit bringing unconfessed sin to our mind, or we begin worrying about our job, our relationships, our finances, our health, or our children. Soon, a full-scale dystopian future starts running on a loop in our brain. We assume we nod it off for a bit, but when we look at the clock, we realize it's been only moments since we last checked. In Proverbs 3, 19 through 24, King Solomon suggested that we can receive sleep benefits when we embrace God's wisdom, understanding, and knowledge. In fact, he claimed, they will be life for you. When you lie down, you will not be afraid, and your sleep will be sweet. Maybe we all need a middle of the night song, prayer, or Bible verse to softly whisper to help us shift our jumbled up thoughts to a mind fully focused on God and his character. A clear conscience and a heart full of gratitude for God's faithfulness and love can bring us sleep that's sweet. Thank you.
Thank you for your presence on this sad and joyful day. Your presence has helped me to be more fully present than I would have thought possible. And I thank you for that. Mildred's beloved family, friends, and I also just want, on a personal note, to say that there are four of us today in this room who grew up on Crescent Street here in Waycross. And I thank you for being the tie that binds today. My earliest memory is, I am 2 years old, sitting with my mother in the backyard of what we always called the little house on Jane Street. A large flock of birds flew across the sky over our heads. My mother said, "Look at the birds, honey." Sometimes I think that this tells you everything you need to know about her. She was the kind of person who would so joyfully share a moment of beauty with her child that it would become that child's first memory. Over the next 68 years, we would share many other joyful moments, and some of them were about birds. When these moments would happen, one of us would often say to the other, "Look at the birds, honey." One dark night on a cruise ship on a dark ocean far from any land, dozens of seabirds flew close by our veranda windows. They dipped and swooped, and the lights from the ship illuminated the undersides of their white bodies and wings. It was a miraculous sight, and it went on longer than anyone would have thought possible. We called it the bird show. One summer, we drove across northern Spain, and forever after, we would talk about that trip as the one where divine providence was our tour guide. Our way was smoothed and illuminated and revealed to us in ways difficult to describe. Sometimes we would wish for something and it would appear. One evening, we were in a city famed for its cathedral and for the storks that nested on its roof. Even though we were staying in a hostel a block from the cathedral, we had yet to see a stork. And even though we were in Spain, we decided that we wanted Italian food for dinner. We left our hostel, walked around the corner, and there was a charming, completely unexpected Italian restaurant. We chose a table outside, and as we sat down, my mother said, "I wish we could see a stork." In the next moment, a stork glided across the rosy blue twilight sky over our heads on its way to the cathedral. And then there were the birds of Baptist Village, the mockingbirds, the hawks, the lone white bird of the lake, and the geese. Sometimes when we heard the squeaky honking of the returning or departing geese, we would step outside Mother's apartment at the Villas to watch their majestic V go across the sky. Last Wednesday, 4 days before she died, I was reading her the trivia questions from that day's Waycross Journal Herald. We knew the answer to the first question and were on our way to our modest weekly goal of 3 correct answers out of 10. Then came question 2. What is a murmuration? We had no idea. Maybe you don't either, so I'll tell you. A murmuration is the flight of a large flock of starlings in a coordinated swooping pattern. Words are like birds. They can take wing and leave us. My mother loved words. Some of her words had already flown ahead of her and waited for her in paradise. Murmuration was the last new word she learned. We were both overcome with the beauty of it. And by the way, did you know that a group of larks is called an exaltation? My mother's favorite number was 333, a trinity of the Trinity. Sunday morning at 3:33, when she was wearing a soft white nightgown printed with tiny red cardinals, she flew away. I wasn't with her when she died, but a few minutes later, I was there, and I was able to feel the warmth leaving her body through that nightgown and say, "Look at the birds, honey."
If any of you have any words or stories that you'd like to share, the family wanted to extend to you this time to do so. I think it's safe to say that what you ladies shared from your heart, not only were they murmurations, but it was an exaltation. Thank you. Let us add our words now to the closing of this moment as we give thanks for the life of Mildred Barber. Heavenly Father, we come before you and thank you for the wonderful and beautiful mysteries of this life. God, we could only hope to live our lives as faithful and true as well. Lord, we thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ and for that love that goes beyond what any word could say or describe, what any eye can see or what any ear can hear. None of these things hold a candle to the love that the Father, that you have for us through Christ. We draw upon that hope today. We pray that comfort for this sweet family and for these friends, for a church congregation, and those that knew her well. Lord, we hold fast to these eternal truths that we will all be together with you one day in paradise. God, would you make these things so? We ask in Jesus' name.